Welcome to the talk on our paper on the scalability of building binary decision diagrams for current feature models, which is joint work by Chico Sundermann, Thomas Thüm and myself. I'm sure you're all familiar with feature models, so I will keep this brief. Feature models consist for one of a feature diagram, which is displayed here, which encodes the hierarchy among the features as well as imposes some constraints on them. For example, exactly one member of an alternative group has to be selected when the parent feature is selected in order for the configuration to be valid. In addition, we may specify cross-tree constraints. In this example, the selection of the feature mushrooms mandates the selection of the feature cheese in order to achieve a valid configuration. Binary decision diagrams represent Boolean formulas as directed acyclic graphs, with the direction being implied from top to bottom. And if we have a Boolean function such as f in this example, then the BDD might look as follows. On the notation quickly, a straight edge denotes the assignment of 1 or true to the variable in the node above, and a dashed edge denotes the assignment of 0 or false to the variable in the node above. If we have a one path from the root node to the one terminal, then this always denotes a satisfying assignment. So we can quickly check that the selection of A as false, B as false, and C as true will satisfy every clause of the Boolean function above and thus satisfy the function f. Also, if we have a path from the root node to the zero terminal, then we can also quickly check that this encodes an assignment that does not satisfy f. And here is another quick example how the BDD would look like for our feature model, which we saw earlier. So what's the big picture of this paper? This paper is an answer, or a partial answer, on the knowledge compilation challenge of Thomas Thüm raised at SPLC 2020, which contains a statement that BDDs do not scale for almost all real-world feature models. And this is interesting because a decade earlier, there is this statement from the work of Mendonça et al., which states that BDDs scale for feature models with less or equal 2,000 features. And so the contents of this work are, we attempted to build BDDs for the most complex publicly available real-world feature models, and we emphasize real-world feature models here. This work also contains a negative result because we failed for almost all feature models, and we will explain a bit why. And it is the goal of this work to establish a baseline for future research so that we can compare advances in BDD construction to this baseline in the future. So let's dive straight into it. These are the results of our experiments. We had a set of 18 feature models in the leftmost column. Why 18? Because CDL is a family of feature models. It consists of about 120, and we randomly picked 10 feature models from this group because they are all very, very similar. So you can see we only managed to build BDDs for 3 feature models, namely Automotive 2 version 1, BusyBox, and Financial Services 1. And you can also see directly that we looked into a number of different experiment setups. We used the infamous Java BDD, which has been used a lot in earlier research. We used the tool Logic to BDD from a paper from Fernandes Amorós et al. From 2020. And we employed our prototype own tool, and also which uses which instruments the same BDD libraries as Java BDD, but in a more direct and more native fashion. So in short, we were able to build BDDs for 3 feature models, but failed for 15 and we define a fail if the computation did not conclude in 10 minutes, which was our time limit. So let's have a look at how far the construction advanced until the time limit then. So we may find out that we just have to use a little bit more time. So as we can see, JavaBDD struggled with all feature models and wasn't able to compete against Logic2BDD and not really against our tool either. And JavaBDD is quite old, has not been developed recently, and also requires expert knowledge to use and to build BDDs because there are little convenience functions. For example, there is no parser for the DIMAX or other input formats. So we can ignore JavaBDD in the following. Looking at the remainder of the results, we find that it is very peculiar that Logic2BDD came very close, apparently, to concluding the computation for Automotive 1 and the Automotive 2 versions 2 to 4, and also to the CDL feature models. This raises two questions. Why is Logic2BDD so much better than our prototype? And the other question is, how much more time do we have to invest to close the gap from 99.7% completion to 100% completion? The first question is answered quickly. Logic2BDD does not use the DIMAX format, but uses an XML-based format. So it has more information on the feature model, for example, the structure and also XOR groups. And it uses them to its advantage and is capable of being much more efficient when constructing a BDD. For the other question, let's look into it a bit more. First, we stayed with one of the comments we got from one of our reviewers. Well, just give it more time and then it's easy done. So, of course, we had the same idea prior to our submission. So we increased our time limit in a pre-experiment to 30 minutes, and we found that Logic2BDD terminates for automotive version 2, versions 2 to 4. But if we increase our time limit to 24 hours, then we are still failing for automotive 1, all CDL feature models and Linux. So the only thing we gain by increasing the time limit is a termination for automotive 2 versions 2 to 4. So we conclude that our configuration is a good compromise of time spent, energy used, and results being representative. But let's look a bit more into our 24-hour experiment and look into the correlation between time spent and percentile of incorporated clauses. And as we can see from this plot, we see nothing. So let's change our time scale to a logarithmic scale. And now we find that this result is very peculiar. For example, after 1 second, or not even 1 second, we have incorporated more than 30% of the clauses into our BDD. After about 10 seconds, we have incorporated more than 95% of clauses into our BDD, and we spent the remainder 23 hours, 59 minutes, and 50 seconds on incorporating the remaining 5% of clauses. In fact, it's quite less, but let's keep with this 5% in the remaining time. So this suggests that there's a bigger problem at hand and that it does not suffice to simply increase the time limit further. Another point we want to look into was to get a prediction. We want a statement, well, tool X scales when metric y is less or equal than z. And in earlier research, we find such statements. As we said earlier, there is a statement from Marsilio Mendonça et al. That BDD scale for feature models with less or equal than 2,000 features. So we looked into this and we denoted the threshold of Mendonça et al. With a magenta line in our plot. So what can we see? We can see that on both ends of the scale we are doing okay. As we said earlier, the orange marks represent the three Automotive 2 versions which we could build a BDD for with a bit more time. The green marks represent the feature models which we could build a BDD for within our time limit, and the red dots are the remaining 15 feature models, or 12 feature models in this case, for which we failed miserably to compile a BDD. And we also see that this number of features apparently is not really usable as a prediction metric, and that the threshold of Mendonça et al. Of 2,000 features does not appear to transfer to real-world feature models or current real-world feature models, as, for example, the CDL feature models are well beyond the threshold of 2,000 features, but we failed to build a BDD for all of them. Another metric which appears in a number of earlier research is the quotient of the number of features divided by the number of cross-T constraints, and again we can see that in both ends of the scale we do quite well, but very close to the bottom, to feature models for which we were able to build a BDD, we see there are the failures for which we could not build a BDD, so this quotient also does not appear to be a good prediction metric. So let's go look into the metric defined by Mendonça et al., which is the quotient of unique features and constraints and the number of features. And again, in this plot, we see that we do very well on both ends of the scale, but not really so for in between. And we also plotted in blue the range of the artificial feature models Mendonça et al. Used for their computation of the threshold of 2,000 features, and we see that only one feature model lies within this threshold, and all other feature models are well beyond or even below this range of for the quotient. So summarizing our results, the statement of Mendonça et al. Appears to not transfer to current real-world feature models. We want to emphasize again that this statement was derived from artificial feature models, which by today's standards are quite under-constrained. And we see the reason that this result does not transfer to current real-world feature models in that these have more features, have way more constraints, and are even more complex, with more features being interconnected by cross-tree constraints and so on. We also saw that predicting BDD building performance is difficult, and the typical metrics used in earlier research are not meaningful for current real-world feature models. And quite interestingly, we found that space is not a problem when building BDDs. We had never had, we never run into any memory problems. The only problem we encountered was time, and our memory demands were well beyond 1 gigabyte of memory. So, why do we need BDDs anyways? Which is also a paraphrasing of one of our reviewers' comments. Well, we want to analyze feature models, and analyzing feature models typically works as follows. We have a feature model and we plug this into a machine, and this machine then tells us these are your dead features, features that do not appear in any valid configuration, these are your core features, features that appear in every valid configuration, these are your false optional features, which are features that are optional in the feature diagram, but due to cross-tree constraints are in fact mandatory, or we get an answer that our feature model is void, so that there is no valid configuration at all. Other answers we get are cardinality based, for example, the feature cardinality, in how many products does a certain feature appear, the configuration cardinality, if we selected or deselected some features, how many products are still able to configure based on this partial configuration, and the feature model cardinality, how many products are encoded by the feature model. And these analyses typically work as follows. We convert the input feature model into a propositional formula. We normalize this formula to a conjunctive normal form or CNF. We express our analysis as a Boolean expression. For example, the propositional formula representing our feature model and then the feature cheese. Then we plug this expression into a SAT solver, and the SAT solver tells us, for example, that the expression is equivalent to false, meaning that it does not have a satisfying assignment. So then we learn that cheese is in fact a dead feature. On the other hand, we can plug this into a SharpSat solver and get a number as an output. For example, if the number result is zero, then we again know that cheese is dead. Otherwise, we know that cheese appears in n products. The performance of SAT solvers is well known and well understood, and there is a big consensus in the community that SAT-based analysis pose no challenges for current state-of-the-art SAT solvers. However, for applications such as variational SAT solving, we have the case that we have millions or potentially millions of SAT solver calls, which might accumulate to be a problem again. SharpSat solving performance has been studied only recently by one of our members of our working group, and it found that SharpSat solvers also perform reasonably well, working for most feature models but the Linux feature model and one proprietary automotive product line. So, beyond satisfiability, we have two common applications that are relevant to Praxis. One being slicing feature models, where we, for example, want to remove features while maintaining the consistency of the cross-tree constraints, and this requires existential quantification. Another use case for this technique is to extract a sub-feature model from a bigger feature model. And the other application are the computation of feature model differences. So we want to know the semantic difference between two feature model versions, which this paper suggests should be expressed also as a feature model. And this requires Boolean operations, e.g. negation, which are potentially cause an explosion of the size of the conjunctive normal form, which we can avoid with BDDs. So why should we use BDDs? Because if you have a BDD for a feature model, then all these SAT solver and SharpSat solver analysis are not necessary anymore. We can compute all this with BDDs. We can solve SAT, we can verify a product, we can compute SharpSat, we can compute the commonality, we can compute negation, consistent disjunction, and we can, which we need again for feature model differences, and we can perform existential quantification or even more general, fully quantified Boolean formula, which we can use for slicing. And these operations are all quite efficient on BDDs. If we go to counting, then we are still efficient, linear with respect to the number of nodes. Composition and disjunction are polynomial in time and space with respect to the size of the BDD, compared to explosion of the conjunctive normal form, and external quantification can also be computed in polynomial time with respect to the size of the BDDs. And we want to stress that this is not feasible with CNF or DDNNF as input. So what are our stay home messages? BDD building requires high sophistication, insight and expert knowledge. So it's not trivial and it requires great care to build BDDs. It is advantageous to take the feature diagram into account, for example, logic to BDD, but it appears that this only helps for under-constrained feature models. And we need to improve the tooling to make BDD building more efficient in order to use it properly for feature model analysis. Again, having a BDD removes the need for SAT or SharpSAT solvers. So our task going forward will be, we want to predict the performance of building BDDs. We want to develop domain-specific heuristics to improve performance, for example, targeting the variable order. And we want to make BDD tooling more accessible in the sense that it does not require expert knowledge to use. And I would like you to contact me. I would love to hear about your experiences with BDDs, to get to know your use cases and, if possible, your instances. And I would love to include your BDD library in my toolchain and apply our benchmarks to your BDD library or your tooling. You can find me below this QR code, which is my personal page. Thank you for your attention, and I'm looking forward to seeing you at SPLC. Bye.